What's up, y'all? This is Anthony the Maze, and I'm here to talk about a question that I get asked a lot as an interview coach, and that is, what kinds of questions should I be asking in a coding interview? As you know from my previous video, I talked about my six-step problem-solving process. If you haven't watched it, I definitely encourage you to go back and check that out so that you can understand my technique for getting through any coding problem. In that process, I talk about the importance of asking questions. In this video, I'm gonna share with you seven questions that you can ask in almost any interview to make sure that you have the information that you need to solve the coding problem. First things first, you should ask if there is a specific language that you need to use for the interview. Many companies may let you use several different programming languages in order to do the coding interview. Or there are some positions where you have to use a specific programming language. It might be that your interviewer needs to see code in a specific language that they understand, and so you need to work with that. Most times before you get into the interview, you know what programming language you're gonna need to use in order to be successful. But even still, if you don't know, or if you didn't have that discussion, then you should definitely ask when you get to the interview and be comfortable working in that language. In interviews that I've had in the past, sometimes I've needed to use a very specific language, and then in others, I was given the choice. It's very important that you ask up front and be very clear about the programming language that you need to use for the coding interview. Another question you should ask is whether you can use functions and libraries that come with your language. If you're using Java, there are tons of data structures that are already implemented as collections in Java. You should ask whether you can use those or whether you need to implement those by yourself. Many times it's okay for you to use libraries and functions that come with your language. It's generally not a problem unless your interviewer specifically says that you can't use a specific function or library, in which case you would need to figure out some other way to do it. It's always tragic when someone assumes that they have to like write their own data structure and they end up spending time starting that process. And I've got to tell them, no, you just use the one that's in Java. It's more important that I understand that you know how to use a data structure than that you know how to implement it from scratch. Implementing a data structure from scratch isn't that useful, generally speaking, but knowing how and when to use it is so much more important. Now, when you're using out-of-the-box functions or libraries, it's very important for you to understand the implications of those functions or libraries. Just because you use the sort method on an array doesn't mean that that's a constant time operation all of a sudden. That sort function has an underlying performance characteristic that you should be familiar with for whatever your given programming language is. Be careful that when you're using data structures and libraries and functions from, you know, whatever language, whether that be Java, JavaScript, C#, whatever it is, that you have a sense for how it performs so that you can have an accurate assessment of the big O time or space complexity. All right, here's another great question you can ask. What is the type of the input? Now, if you've heard the problem expressed, generally speaking, you're gonna start to figure out, you might be able to figure out what the input type is just from the way the problem is described. So for instance, if someone tells you to sort an array of whole numbers, that's probably gonna be an int32 type. But that could be int64 if the numbers are particularly large. You just wanna make sure that you confirm and clarify the type of the input. And don't be afraid if the interviewer turns that question back on you to ask what your opinion is. Just be honest, use your experience and take your best guess. If you're wrong, your interviewer can nudge you in the right direction to correct you. So be listening for feedback so that if you need to make an adjustment, they're there to help you. Thinking through data types can be a great way to understand how someone thinks about design in the small in object-oriented design. Think about how much space you need, think about the size, and choose the data type that is going to be the best representation for that. Another super important question that you should be asking is if the input will always be valid. It's fine to check for edge cases and to be thinking about those things. Sometimes your interviewer is going to expect you to identify and handle certain edge conditions. Other times, it doesn't really matter. They don't want you to be distracted by those small details and want you to work on the core functionality. So always ask if you need to handle edge cases so that you can factor that in your brainstorming and in your implementation. As you well know, things don't always go as you expect, and sometimes you need to handle things that don't fall on the happy path. By asking whether the input is always going to be valid, that will tell you whether you need to handle certain edge conditions or border conditions in the implementation phase. And this could go either way. Some people will want you to identify and handle those things. Other people really won't care, and they just want you to focus on the core functionality. But it's important for you to ask so that you don't spend time doing that if you didn't need to do that in the first place. Now, another question that you can ask that some people can find a little scary is, does the input fit in memory? Now, the reason why this is scary is because your interviewer might say, no, the input doesn't fit in memory. And now you need to think about how you would design a solution at a larger scale, usually involving multiple computers. In my experience, most of the time, the input does fit in memory. And I, as an interviewer, appreciate when candidates are thinking about large-scale distributed systems, especially when you're interviewing for a big tech company. Most times I'm gonna say that the input fits into memory, but later on I may ask you how you would change your solution to adapt for a situation where it doesn't fit in memory. Remember, especially with big tech companies, you're often working with data that doesn't fit on a single machine. And so knowing how to use strategies like MapReduce or sharding or breaking up a problem so that it can be pre-computed across multiple machines and then combining the results together. These are the strategies that we use. Now, the great news is that if the data doesn't fit in memory, there are tried and tested, well-known strategies for how to solve that problem. So there are a few patterns that you can use, and all you have to do is just use them. You probably won't have to write out the code for a solution that handles data that doesn't fit on a single machine. A lot of times that's just a discussion between you and your interviewer with regards to how you would do it. Here's another clutch question that you should be asking. Is the input sorted? There are at least two reasons why that question is super important. Number one, if the data is already sorted, then maybe I don't need to use any additional sorting algorithms. And typically sorting algorithms are gonna be somewhere in the neighborhood of n log n to n squared. And so if I know that the input's already sorted, then I may not need those algorithms, thus reducing the amount of time that it takes my algorithm to run. But another reason why that question is important is because if the data is sorted, maybe there are some strategies that I can use when the data is sorted. So for instance, there are algorithms that only work on sorted data, such as binary search. If the data is sorted, that might be a big clue that I can use something like binary search to effectively find, you know, some data or a condition or whatever it may be. If I'm working on a search problem and I know that the input is sorted, then I know that I can probably use binary search, or I should be thinking about binary search because the input is sorted. All right, here's one more question you can think about. How do we define optimal? Many of us, when we're working on coding problems, are really only worried about big O time complexity, and that can be a mistake. Many times it's gonna be appropriate to optimize for big O time complexity, but what if your interviewer wants you to optimize for space complexity? You wouldn't know if you didn't ask. So don't assume that you're always just optimizing for speed. Maybe you're optimizing for space, or maybe you're optimizing for something that isn't either of those two things, like the fastest solution to implement, or the simplest solution to implement, or maybe even the cheapest solution. So don't assume that everything needs to be as fast as possible. Sometimes that's not how we define optimality, either in the interview or in real life. Make sure that you have a conversation with your interviewer about what they consider optimal and strive for that. Now, as an interviewer, sometimes I've left it up to the candidate to tell me what they prefer. And the reason is because it helps me to understand how they're thinking about trade-offs. All right, now I have a question for you. Did you enjoy this video? Are there questions that you like to ask in coding interviews that maybe I didn't cover? Is there a question that you always forget to ask that would help you to do better in interviews? Let me know in the comments and let's talk about it. All right, y'all, you know what time it is. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Peace.